Welcome to Your Voice. I'm Julia Lokendi. Senator Cathy Young is here to discuss local hotspots for jobs, as well as how you can give back to your community.
The last programs, we talked about how the budget helps businesses, families, seniors, agriculture, and farmers. Now today I want to talk about economic development and as well as libraries. So tell us, let's start with libraries, and tell us how the budget fared with libraries.
You know, I've always been an avid supporter of libraries ever since I was elected to the State Assembly in 1999, and in fact, the first leadership position I had was that I was ranking member of the Libraries Committee, Libraries and Technology, and as soon as I was elected, one of the first things I did is that I did a tour of every single library in my assembly district. And that commitment to libraries continues today because they're so important, especially in our rural communities, but in every community that is fortunate enough to have a library. And our libraries work very hard, but in many cases, they're the hub of the community and they provide so many valuable services. For example, most of my libraries have after-school programs or summer enrichment programs for students, for young people, and help continue to enrich their lives and further their education. Also, libraries have gotten to be critically important in these times when a lot of people are out of work, people are looking for new jobs, and it's very important because many of the libraries serve as a hub where people can go and apply for jobs. A lot of jobs now have to be applied for online, and in some cases in rural areas such as mine, people may not have access to the internet, they may not be able to afford a computer. And so libraries are really important resources, and my library's directors tell me that they've been spending a lot of time helping people look for jobs.
Right. And you were able to bump up what the governor had proposed in his budget for libraries.
I was. You know, it's been a very tough few years for many entities across the state because we've had a fiscal crisis, we had to cut state spending. You always want to cut wasteful spending, but you also want to keep vital programs. And the libraries are extremely vital, as I said. You know, and as a matter of fact, I had a blast the other day because I went to see some seniors who were learning how to use computers and the internet. And it can be very kind of scary for seniors to learn all those things. They're not like you see these little kids that are totally into it. At a very early age, and they were so excited, and many of our seniors are going to libraries so that they can email their grandchildren or go to the World Wide Web and so on. But during the budget process the last couple of years, it has been tough. Libraries did sustain some cuts. I voted against the cuts. But last year, through the Senate's efforts, we were able to restore $2.6 million to libraries across the state. And this year, the governor proposed about $81.6 million in library funding. And in the final budget, because of the Senate, we were able to actually restore another $4 million to libraries. And I know that the libraries across the state are just thrilled with that.
Yeah, the broadband is a really important. I mean, we talked about last week with the telehealth and the scarce amount of internet capability. So you can go to a library and use their internet.
You can. And, of course, they still have the books and all those other
cards.
Enrichment. And, you know, many of my libraries also, they're able to qualify for mini grants through the Arts Council. And they bring so much culture and enrichment to our smaller communities especially. So they may have music on the lawn during the summer. And it really shows that they really are such an important community gathering place. So I'm just thrilled about it. You know, we're continuing, by the way, when you speak of broadband, continuing to push to bring broadband to rural areas so that we can compete through the economy, too. And I sponsored legislation through the Rural Resources Commission that would make a change in the law. It's a technical change, but it would actually open up all kinds of federal grants so that we can continue to build that broadband infrastructure in the state. And that, of course, ties into jobs and economic growth and vitality and opportunity and everything that we're striving for.
Yeah, and that also brings us to something that you've been a constant advocate for, and that is the SUNY Fredonia Technology Incubator. It's a really cool thing. Tell us about it.
It really is, and you know, it's something that I helped start several years ago, probably about 4 or 5 years ago. SUNY Fredonia had an idea to do an incubator program. And basically, what I mean by an incubator, it's not where you keep baby chicks necessarily, but it is a place where you nurture fledgling businesses. And there's a picture of us, of me meeting with several entrepreneurs who currently are looking to either be in the incubator or already are in the incubator. SUNY Fredonia originally wanted to build it right on campus. And I felt very strongly that it would not have the same economic impact if it were on the campus, that we needed to do it in downtown Dunkirk, because I also have been working over the years to revitalize Dunkirk. And so it was a perfect opportunity. We were able to convince the former president of SUNY Fredonia, and he went on board, and we built the incubator, revitalized that part of Dunkirk. But now there's so many businesses that are starting there. And I met with a couple of businesses, too, that started at the incubator. And now they've been able to establish their businesses. They moved out of the incubator because they were doing so well. And they established their businesses in the region, and they're growing jobs. And that's really what it's all about. Mm-hmm. And we have the entrepreneurial spirit at the incubator. It was interesting because these incubators that are affiliated with colleges are a way to take some of the technology, some of the academic ideas, some of the research that's being initiated in college campuses, and commercializing it so that we can grow the economy. So it's very exciting.
Yeah, it is. And not a lot of people have the money, but they do have the ideas, so I think this would work perfectly for something like
right,
that.
Right, exactly, because at the incubator they are able to have space to grow their businesses, and it's very low cost to them. They have access to ways to grow their and develop their business plans. They have ways to grow their marketing. And I met with two students. They were at that table that in that photograph that we showed earlier. And they would like to go to the incubator. Now, they're students. They're not even out, you know, in the working place yet. You see them in the blue shirt, the two there. And they have a great idea. They want to start a business that helps bands be able to have access to recording. And they're both taking media programs at SUNY Fredonia. So, you know, it's just great. And the more that we do this, that we are able to start businesses in New York State, the more jobs that will grow and the better that we'll be able to compete with other states.
Yeah. So what were you able to manage in the budget for this incubator?
Well, I was able to secure a $100,000 grant to help with the operations of the incubator. And it's very important. I met with Virginia Horvath, who is the new SUNY Fredonia president. And she said that they really needed the assistance. We were able to get it. And it's a great investment in our local economy, because so often we see that young people get a fantastic education in New York State, and then they feel that they have to move away in order to get a good paying job. And that's why this is so important and so exciting.
Yeah, it is exciting. So we will keep our eye on this and have updates for sure.
Yeah.
So this past weekend, there was an effort to help reverse the trend for the dwindling numbers of the volunteer firefighters.
There's an initiative to actually start to grow the volunteer ranks, as you pointed out, in our volunteer fire departments, and they are so crucial to our communities. And, you know, I have nothing but gratitude for the volunteers who step up. And this past weekend, I was at Randolph Volunteer Fire Dinner. We honored a member who had been serving for 60 years, but it really shows that we have members who have dedicated a good share of their lives to volunteer service, but we need a new crop coming up so that they can continue to keep our volunteer fire departments strong. And so we have this whole effort to recruit new volunteers, and many of my volunteer fire departments across the southern tier in Livingston County held special events, and it was like an open house to bring people in so that they could discuss possibly joining. Just this last weekend, I was at the Houghton Volunteer Fire Dinner, and then I went to the Nunday Volunteer Fire Dinner in Livingston County. And, you know, when you think about it, it's so profound what they do, because whenever there's danger, they run toward it instead of running away from it. And they oftentimes put themselves in very dangerous situations. And just on a national level, we saw what happened in Boston with the bombings that happened at the Boston Marathon, and all those first responders were right there. They didn't know what was going on. You know, you can imagine the chaos where these massive bombs went off and people are maimed and killed, and you didn't know what was going to happen next. But they ran toward the danger instead of away from it. Same in West Texas when we had that terrible tragedy recently. And 3/4 of that volunteer fire department was either severely injured or killed. And they knew that they had a limited amount of time trying to put that initial fire out before there was a massive explosion. They knew it. They were desperately trying to do that, and they saved many lives as a result. But unfortunately, we lost our brave volunteers in West Texas. And so it is very significant that we have so many people are willing to step up, mm-hmm. But we need more. Maybe it's not as dramatic as the Boston bombings and what happened in West Texas, but every day they're protecting their neighbors, our communities, and it really is important that we show them every time we have the chance how much we value what they do.
Yeah, that is a standout point. So they don't just need people to go in and fight fires, too. They also need other volunteers.
You're right. You don't have to necessarily get all the certification, but maybe you can drive the ambulance. Maybe you can't, and you know, not go through as much training. Maybe you can provide support services through the auxiliary. Maybe you could be a fire policeman that directs traffic at an emergency scene. Maybe you can help raise money to support the volunteer fire department. So there are so many opportunities out there where you can really make a difference.
Yeah, and if anyone wants to help out their community this weekend, they can do that with I Love My Parks Day.
Well, this is another great event, and this is from a previous year where people can go and volunteer and help clean up the parks. Now, I'm lucky because I actually have 6 state parks in my Senate district, and there are events this weekend at Midway Park, which is an old-time amusement park in Chautauqua County. The state acquired it several years ago. It has great sentimental value, and it's family fun, but we need volunteers for there. Allegheny State Park, which is a premier park in my district, and that actually is a picture from Allegheny State Park. Volunteers working away, and it's a great opportunity to get outdoors, get a little exercise, and enjoy the beauty that we have. There are also events at the Genesee Valley Greenway to help there, and Letchworth State Park, which spans between Livingston and Wyoming counties, but that is the Grand Canyon of the East. Just spectacular. So if people can volunteer, we'd love to see you.
And you have all this information on your website, young.nysenate.gov.
That's right.
So during one of your many stops in your district, you spent time with the Almond Historical Society.
This is a dedicated group of volunteers, and there's so many records, written records and artifacts from Allegheny County that are included in this facility. So these are volunteers, and they invited me to see some of the progress. They actually added on an addition to the Historical Society, and I'm just so proud of what they're able to do because they work so hard, and they've gone through all of the written records that they have. They've archived them, you know, they're organized now, and now it's very important, as you know, to preserve our history. And they're working every single day to do that.
Great. You also recently awarded a service medal to a decorated Korean War veteran from Little Genesee. He played a role in developing one of the Army's first remote-controlled tanks. Pretty cool.
That's right. And this is Lyle Edwards. He was a sergeant. It was just such a special event because he is a special person. He's contributed to his community. But you can see the number of medals that he earned.
With you?
Yes, all with me. And I'm always struck because so many of our veterans come to my office for some other issue. They may come for health issue, you know, something with the VA or something else. And we always ask them whether they've gotten all of the decorations that they deserve. And it's basically shocking to find out that so many of our veterans never got all the medals that they qualified for.
Why is that?
You know, some came home from war and they just wanted to get back to regular life. Some didn't receive the medals because there was a big fire in St. Louis many years ago where a lot of the military records were stored. And so a lot of the people's histories and records were actually destroyed in the fire. So you have to reconstruct all that. But we've had many special events across the district. So it's my mission, if I come across a veteran who deserves that recognition, I'm going to make sure that that person, he or she, gets it.
That's really great. Thank you so much for being with us today, Senator.
Thanks, Julia.
Thank you for watching Your Voice with Senator Cathy Young. For more details on the issues we discussed or additional information on how you can give back to your community, young.mysenate.gov.